Thank you for joining the online worship service of Waynesboro Grace. Our mission is to glorify God by making disciple-making disciples. For more information about our church, you can find us online at waynesborograce.org or on Facebook at Waynesboro Grace.
You're the only answer to the darkness. You're the only right among the wrong. You're the only hope among the chaos. You are the voice that calls me on. Louder than every lie, my sword is.
Struggles on the way,
but with joy our hearts can sing. Yes, our hearts can sing. Never
everyone. This morning, for our reading, we will be reading from Revelation chapter 1. So Revelation 1 verses 1 through 8. And that says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his bondservants the things which must soon take place. And he sent and communicated it by his angel to his bondservant John, who testified to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even all that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of the prophecy and heed the things which are written in it, for the time is near. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and released us from our sins by his blood. And he has made us to be a kingdom, priests to his God and Father. To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn over him. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty." Let's pray together this morning. God, I thank you this morning for the opportunity to be together. I thank you for the many ways that you provide for us even in times of uncertainty, that we know that the truth that you have given us in your word is certain. And so thank you for this opportunity to come together and worship you, and by returning you the praise that you are due, to giving you the things that you have given us, that we give back to you in thankfulness, and then God going back into the world and worshiping you by the things that we do and say. So we ask that you would give us the strength and the wisdom to do that this week, and we thank you for the opportunity that you've given to us to do that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Justin. As we continue to worship, would you stand with us? We're going to do Give Me Jesus next. And I just pray that this would be our prayer all the time. And no matter what we're doing, that Jesus would be our first thought and our first goal. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. To die, when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. Just give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, you can have all this world, you can have all this. Just give me Jesus. When I fear,
when I fear, my faith will fail. Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, Christ will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold.
This morning and spend some time together with you. You may have a seat. I love that song. I love both of those songs we just sang and how they fit so well with what we're going to spend some time looking at in Revelation chapters 1 to 3 this morning by way of summary regarding where we have been and just that truth that he will hold us fast. And I don't know about you, but I feel like things continue to change quickly in our lives right now. And there is just something secure about those promises that God has made to us in his word, that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he has promised to hold us fast. And so it's in the good name of Jesus that we gather here this morning because of what he's done for us and in celebration and response to that. So it's good to be here. And I'm grateful to be here with you.
Seven churches, one province. Seven churches, one apocalypse. Seven churches, one Savior. Seven churches, one Revelation.
All right. Well, if you could make your way back to your seats, and as you do, grab your Bibles, that would be great. We're going to try to summarize today, what it is that we've been looking at and thinking about over the last several weeks together. I should actually say months more accurately together. And what we've been doing is we've been trying to understand and look at and see what it is that Jesus instructed the Apostle John to write to these seven churches that existed in what we know as Asia Minor or Western Turkey, that area of the world, the region of the world. And these letters show up in the book of Revelation. And what the book does is in chapter one, there's essentially an introduction that's made. It's the introduction. It's what John initially sees. It's then the instruction that John receives from Jesus. And then the vision John has of Jesus. And then chapters 2 and 3 function as these letters, which quite frankly act a little bit more like postcards in the sense that they're not terribly lengthy in and of themselves, but they would have then been all comprised into one letter or one book of scripture that we know and understand and call to be the Revelation. And what would have happened was, as John was instructed, chapter 1's this introduction, chapters 2 and 3 are these letters to the churches that all were real churches, all existed in space and time and history, and Jesus writes to them, giving them commendation, at times giving them confrontation, but addressing the things that are going well, addressing the things that they need to be thinking about. And then chapters 4 and 5, Jesus presents, or John, by the Spirit, is given this vision of the throne. And in chapters 4 and 5, by John's vision, we are transported into the heavenlies and are given this vision of the throne. Chapters 6 to 19, 6 to 20 then function as more of the predictive element of prophecy, the this is coming in the future aspect of prophecy, and chapters 21 and 22 function the same way. However, the battle's over. The battle is done, and Jesus has reigned victoriously, and you have the new heavens and new earth coming down from the heavens and earth, and you have then eternity forevermore spent between and with God and his people. We've been looking at these seven letters that were written to the churches that existed in Western Turkey. And to just throw them on the screen to remind you of kind of where they existed, that yellow dot near just to the left of the middle of your screen, that's where John was. He tells us in chapter 1 that he had been exiled on the island of Patmos, and he was there. He had been exiled on account of his faith in Christ, on account probably of his ministry, and he got stuck on an island. But it didn't stop his ministry. He began and continued to function as a leader in the local church, and then Jesus comes to him and says, you need to write some letters for me, and it is going to be addressed to these seven churches. And so there's seven blue dots there on the screen. The lower left blue dot, that's Ephesus. That's where chapter 2 begins. And it begins with that letter in and to those in Ephesus. And then what happened, and as Jesus wrote these letters, these dots and the letters themselves followed the mail route of the day. And so the dot just to the north of Ephesus is Smyrna. If we go all the way up to the north, we find ourselves in Pergamum, and then we begin sliding southward. And the lower right blue dot is the last letter, and that was what we looked at last week, and the church of, or the city of, Laodicea. And these churches had significant influence in the region. These cities had significant influence in the region. I think we can see in the fact that Jesus identifies these churches and then writes letters to these churches a couple things. One being, everything Jesus said about what was happening in the churches was happening in the churches. So he picked them and wrote letters to them because these were real things happening. And he needed to communicate to them and chose to use the Apostle John to do so. The other thing I think we can see there, because of the significance that these churches would have had, is that Jesus sees these churches as having influence in the other areas and regions of the world, or this little part of the world, I should say. But perhaps most simply, these churches were the fastest way, or these cities were the fastest way for information to be disseminated. And so these letters were written and they were given to a postal worker who would have followed the postal circuit and would have delivered these letters, probably in total the entire book of Revelation, but they would have all had and received all seven of them and then the other parts as well. And it's really no different than how that functions today. We just finished an election cycle where if your mailbox was like my mailbox, you had hundreds of pieces of political literature come and be delivered over the course of about 2 months. And that was the fastest way to disseminate information. It may actually not be the fastest anymore, but it was a way to disseminate information. And it's no different for these churches here. What we've been trying to do over the last several months together is we've been trying to understand what Jesus has written to these churches. And we've been trying to ask ourselves, as we today, in 2020, live, who do we want to be known for? Jesus gives a list of things and identifies a list of things that he commends that these churches have done. He gives a list and identifies a list of the things that he confronts these churches for. We should be asking ourselves, are the things that Jesus commends, the things that we're searching after and seeking after, are the things that Jesus confronts true in our midst? Who do we want to be known for? And that's going to work itself out on an individual and a collective and in a corporate aspect. And so we've been asking ourselves, as I follow Jesus in 2020, who do I want to be known for? As we follow Jesus, who is it that we want to be known for? And what I want to do this morning by way of summary is we're going to think back at the big ideas that each of these letters included in them. But I want us to also, before we get to that aspect, think about and just remind ourselves that the temptation to just take everything Jesus commends and put it on one side of a piece of paper, and everything Jesus condemns and puts on another side of paper is real. And what if we're not careful we end up doing is just finding ourselves with a new checklist to check off. And that's going to do one of two things. It's going to lead us in one of two directions. If we do the list well, it's going to lead us to pride. And we're going to go, look at our list. Look at all those check marks. Yeah, I might have, you know, blew it on Wednesday, but how about the other 6 days of the week? Look at my list. Or it's going to lead us to despair. And we're going to go, look at my list. I don't have a single tally mark. And I don't think Jesus intends for what he commends and confronts to function in either regard. Like all of the other commands in the scripture, there's going to be a couple things that we just need to know. When Jesus tells me to do something, or when the Bible tells me to do something, I'm going to be naturally inclined to do the opposite. So if we're told to go and fill in the blank, I'm going to be inclined to not do that. If I'm told to not do something, I'm going to be inclined to want to do the very opposite. But the whole point in all of that is not to give you or I a list. When we find ourselves with a list, we're going to either slide to pride because we look at our list and think that we're a little better than we actually are. Or we're going to slide to despair because we're going to look at our list and go, I'm not as good as I thought I was. What Jesus intends is to reveal both what he wants for us, what he wants us to pursue, but also to remind us that the way we pursue that is by walking with him. Paul says in the book of Galatians in chapter 5 that it is by walking in the Spirit that we don't gratify the desires of the flesh. And so Jesus, in these letters, if we can just pull that language from Paul, I think is identifying what it looks like to walk in the Spirit. And also, perhaps, where our flesh is going to want to have itself gratified. And so the point is to not find ourselves with a list of things that we now begin to check off day in and day out. The point is to be reminded that it's walking in the Spirit, and by walking in the Spirit, that we are able to say no to the desires of the flesh. And here, this is what this looks like. This is what Jesus would have for us. This is his best for us. But we only find it by walking with him and in the Spirit that he has given us. And so the big idea of the morning, as we look at all of these letters, and I don't want this to be missed, the big takeaway is to stay close to Jesus. It's what we just sang a few minutes ago, give me Jesus. And if that sounds like just your pastor telling you that you need to spend time each day reading your Bible and praying, that's exactly what it is that I'm saying, okay? So if you thought that, we're on the same page there. But as well, it's also with God's people. Because the Spirit's going to work through prayer, it's going to work through the Word, and it's going to work through God's people. And we want to stay close to Jesus. And we don't do so by a checklist. We do so by pursuing a relationship. And so we want to try to just see what it is that Jesus commends. What's his best for us? But also what it actually looks like to follow him. And in many ways, how you and I are incapable of doing this without his help. And so he empowers what he requires because he's gracious in that way. So let's pray. And then we're going to hop into the text, and we'll be in a lot of different passages this morning, but we wanted to be thinking about these things in the time that we have remaining. Would you join me? Father God, we ask that you would help us to think well about these things. That as Jesus said to every one of these seven churches, that he who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says. Well, God, we pray that you would give us those ears to hear, those eyes to see, the minds to understand, the hearts to believe, the hands and feet that are going to go and do. And God, as we think of what it looks like to go and do, several of these churches, you specifically commend their work. Help us to understand and think of that word and that idea correctly. That it's not by works that we're saved. It's by your grace through faith. It is not of ourselves. And yet you have prepared for us good works to walk in. We want to walk in them, and we want to do so by the power of your Spirit. That in doing so, love may abound in us and through us, and we would not gratify the desires of the flesh. So Jesus, help us to see these things this morning. And in doing so, just shine the spotlight on yourself and your love and your grace and your mercy and your goodness and the very best that you would have for us. And we pray this in your good name. Amen. Well, we want to just try to remind ourselves a little bit of what Justin read earlier, and that's that John in chapter 1 gives us a threefold description of who Jesus is, and then a threefold description of what it is that Jesus has done. And these things matter as we're trying to just kind of get ourselves set into the context of what Jesus is going to reveal about himself. So look at verse 4. You see in the latter part of verse 4 an expression there, first of all, of the Trinity. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. That would be the Father. And from the seven spirits who are before his throne. That would be the Holy Spirit. And the reference there of seven spirits, I think, is a way to refer to the completed Spirit. Not that he was lacking anything and needed something added to him, but there was a fullness there. Isaiah chapter 11 gets after that a little bit to round out those seven aspects of the Holy Spirit. Then in verse 5, you have, and from Jesus Christ. And John gives us a threefold description of who Jesus is. He is the faithful witness. What Jesus says is true. He is the firstborn of the dead, the ruler of the kings on earth. That expression, firstborn of the dead, is this idea of preeminence. It's idea of sovereignty. It's an idea of authority. There, it even pulls into it the idea of first fruits that we see written about more explicitly in 1 Corinthians 15, that Jesus has paved the way for us and that his resurrection is going to be the pattern that our bodily resurrection follows. And he's the firstborn among the dead. Paul says it this way in Colossians chapter 1, that he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Jesus is the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning. Jesus is the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. The idea there is of authority. It's of sovereignty. It's of rulership. And you see that expressed there, that he's the ruler of the kings on earth. This threefold description of who Jesus is. And just think of how comforting that would have been to these seven churches, many of whom are in the midst of kings on earth ruling in ways that are poor. Two of them specifically being ruled by kings that wanted to take their lives physically, affect their lives economically, and another where they were marginalized and pushed to the outskirts of society. And here John reminds us of who this Jesus is. The kings of earth do not have the last word. Jesus does. And then he moves into telling us and reminding us or giving us this threefold description of who Jesus, or what Jesus has done there in the second part of verse 6, to him who loves us, who has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priest to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. This expression of Jesus as, and the description of what he has done is significant because he has loved us. He set us free from our sin by dying on the cross for us, and he's made us a kingdom of priests to his God. It is only through Jesus that we are mediated to God. There's only one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ, as Paul writes in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. You don't need a priest here on earth to stand in the gap between you and God. And I am not your priest who would stand in the gap between you and God. Jesus is the high priest, and he has made all of us who have trusted in him priests. That means all of us can go to the Father because of what the Son has done. We don't go to the Father because the guy that works at Waynesboro Grace has a special in. Now, Jesus is the one and only mediator, and in that, as our high priest, has made us priests, and we've been given access to God, and we can draw near to the throne because of who Jesus is. And we're called to stay close to Jesus. Jesus said this regarding the closeness of this relationship. He's having a conversation with his disciples in the upper room, and he is telling them, I'm going to ask the Father, and he's going to give to you a helper to be with you forever. The Spirit of truth, who the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, that's the Holy Spirit, for he dwells in you and will be with you. As we think of just the idea of staying close to Jesus, again, we're not trying to come up with a checklist of things to work through tomorrow morning to either feel good about or despair over. We're trying to understand what's Jesus's best for us, and what God requires of us, he empowers in us. And Paul gets after that in Philippians 2 regarding this idea of you and I working, but then the very energy that we're given to actually complete the work. So there in verse 12, Paul says, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. We can look at a list from Revelation chapter 2 and 3 and see a whole bunch of ways to work out our salvation. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's Jesus' best for us. It's what he wants for us. But let's not miss this. It's God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. And that work that Paul uses there regarding the activity of God is different than the word that Paul uses for work to reflect and refer to our activity. The word that Paul uses there regarding the activity of God means energy. And every time I think about this, I think of the Energizer Bunny. And I think of those commercials that aired all the time when I was a kid at Christmas time because they wanted my parents to know that they should buy the toys and not forget the batteries. And so I have this image of that white bunny with drumsticks pounding on the drum. And the battery gives the bunny the energy. That's what Paul is saying here. God gives us the energy to do what it is that he requires us to do. So this is not you and I trying to do better on our own. This is you and I walking by the Spirit. This helper that Jesus has sent to us. This complete Spirit that is actually also authoring this book and these letters as well. This Spirit that is speaking through Jesus, through the Apostle John, to these churches and by extension us. And we just are reminded time and time again to stay close to Jesus. And so it's in the letter of and to the church in Ephesus that I think we can see that we are given a picture of what it looks like and how we evaluate mission and vision. How do we evaluate mission and vision? And I think the question for us to try to take away and pull from that is, are we loving like Jesus? This church in Ephesus is commended by Jesus for 9 different things that they're doing exceptionally well. And we're not going to work through the list this morning. But Jesus lists 9 different things that they are doing exceptionally well. And then he says, but I have this one thing against you. You've abandoned your first love. And see, there's a temptation, I think, at times in the church that we can evaluate our mission and vision, and we can evaluate perhaps even our success as a local body by all of the good things that we're doing, and we might miss the fact that we're doing all those good things without actually loving one another and or a lost world. How we evaluate mission and vision, I think, is one of the big ideas of the letter there to the church in Ephesus. And the question for us to take away is, have we loved like Jesus? Jesus said this again in the upper room with his disciples, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. It's an astounding statement. It's an all-encompassing, comprehensive statement. But Jesus here is not listing a whole bunch of things that his disciples are going to need to go and do to somehow stand out and be identified as his disciples. He rather gives them one thing that will be the marking characteristic of them as his followers, and that's love and how they love one another. The church in Ephesus and that letter to that church, I think, helps us evaluate mission and vision. We're not just trying to do the right activities. We're trying to love well. Have we loved like Jesus? Because we want to stay close to him. The letter to the church in Smyrna, I think, leads us to consider how we are to count the cost of discipleship. And that church was one that was persecuted. That church was one where Jesus commends them, giving no confrontation, having no condemnation for any of their actions or activities. He only gives them commendation. And then he goes so far as to tell them, look, it's going to go badly for you. You're going to be arrested. You're going to be imprisoned. And then you're going to lose your life. Hold fast unto death. How do we count the cost of discipleship? What is it that we are called to? Perhaps the question there is, have we sacrificed like Jesus? Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 16, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. It's believed that where Jesus was at this point during his earthly ministry, it is quite likely that there were crucified individuals within eyesight of where he and his disciples would have had this conversation. He very likely could have pointed to people hanging on a cross as the picture of what following him would look like. And he continues, whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Jesus writes to the church in Smyrna, reminding them of the cost of discipleship. And he doesn't tell them to somehow modulate their passion and zeal and faithfulness to him. He commends them for those things and then says, you're going to lose your earthly life, but I will give you the crown of everlasting life. And he leads them to consider, perhaps at its most poignant moment for them, what it looks like to make that trade. What it looks like to be willing to lay down your life physically for Christ because of the promise of an eternal crown. And he asks them and commands them to hold fast. Hey, Smyrnans, stay close to me. To Pergamum, we, I think, are reminded or shown, perhaps given questions to evaluate how and where we find satisfaction. How and where we find satisfaction. Perhaps even the encouragement of one another to not trade true satisfaction for poor imitations and substitutes. There, I think the question perhaps is just, do we find or search for satisfaction like Jesus? There, to again borrow an example from the life of Jesus. Here he's having this conversation with the woman at the well. He's in Samaria. His disciples have gone and they've tried to find some food to eat. They come back and now they're urging him to eat. And Jesus says, I have food to eat that you don't know about. And his disciples are just wondering, who brought him food before us? Did he not send us out to go and look for food? Who beat us back? And Jesus replies, my food's to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. It was the church in Pergamum that was being tempted to find satisfaction elsewhere. They were tempted to follow the teaching of Balaam, which was a teaching that led the people of Israel in Numbers 24 and 25 to find satisfaction elsewhere. And God had provided the people of Israel at that point in their history bread, manna, and quail, and he had given them everything they needed for sustenance and nourishment while they journeyed through the wilderness. And it was Balaam who taught the king of Moab, Balak, how to tempt the men of Israel to find satisfaction elsewhere. And he did so with the women of Moab and steak dinners. And these things show up in the church, in the letter to the church in Pergamum. You're being tempted to go and eat food sacrificed to idols. You're being tempted to find satisfaction elsewhere. And we're reminded to stay close to Jesus, to enjoy the good gifts that he's given us, absolutely. But to be very careful of the temptations that exist to go and find satisfaction elsewhere. We're reminded to stay close to Jesus. To the letter of, or in the church in Thyatira, I think we are given a picture of how we live in the world and not be of the world. Perhaps to frame that in the form of a question, do we stand for truth like Jesus? Jesus didn't mince words. He didn't mince words when he had conversations with the Pharisees. He didn't mince words when he had conversations with Pilate. He might not have used all the words that he could have used, but he didn't mince words, and he didn't pull many punches. And he told his disciples, again, in the upper room, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." What does it look like to stand for truth like Jesus? The church in Thyatira, like the church in Ephesus, had a list of commendable things. The things on the Thyatira's list were actually very similar to the things on the list of the church of Ephesus, with one notable exception. Those in Thyatira did not have the same standard of false teachers that the church in Ephesus did. The church in Thyatira entertained the false teachers. They entertained who Jesus says is a prophetess by the name of Jezebel that's teaching and leading people in all sorts of licentiousness. The church in Ephesus would have been aghast to consider the fact that a church not too far from them would have erred in such a way. But the church in Thyatira had erred in such a way, and we are reminded by the instruction that Jesus gives to them that how we stand for truth matters. And to stay close to Jesus is to stay close to the faithful witness. It's to stay close to the one who is the way, the truth, and the life. To the church in Sardis, we see that we're called to live with alertness and confidence. That church believed that it was alive. But Jesus says of them, "You're actually dead." Perhaps there we could ask the question, do we live with a determined purpose like Jesus lived, regardless of what others might say to us? Is our purpose determined? Do we live with alertness and confidence? And Jesus, again, not pulling any punches, instructing his disciples of what this would look like. And here we're going to begin to see some themes overlapping. But he says, look, they're going to deliver you up to tribulation and put you to death. You'll be hated by all the nations for my name's sake. Then many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another. And many false prophets will arise and lead many astray. And because of lawlessness will be increased. The love of many will grow cold. But the one who endures will be saved to the end. There's a call for you and I to live with alertness and confidence. You see that work itself out in what Jesus writes to the church in Sardis. They were a church that probably had a really good beginning. They were a church that might not have known they were dead, might have thought that they were alive and healthy and functioning well, and Jesus has the hard words for them that they're not. I was thinking about this morning, and the movie Weekend at Bernie's popped into mind. And it's been a long time since that was on my radar, so if that was an inappropriate movie, I probably shouldn't have watched it as a kid, but I did. And it was this idea that, like, this dude whose name was Bernie died, but nobody wanted to leave his house because he was throwing this massive epic party. And so they just dressed him up like he was alive and pretended all weekend to keep him in kind of the midst of the happenings at this party. And the church in Sardis was a little bit like that. They were faking, in some regards, life they thought they had that Jesus says to them, "You don't have at all." How do we live with alertness and confidence? And we thought through that morning and thinking about this letter that confidence is this idea and this expression that says we can do this. What God calls us to, both personally and collectively, we can do it. And confidence then is worked out through dependence on God and interdependence on one another. And so we can do this because we know who God is, and we're going to spend time with one another. We're going to be interdependent on one another. We're going to be dependent on God. But confidence can very subtly and very quickly give way to arrogance. And arrogance would just simply say, "We got this." So we don't need to depend on God. Perhaps we don't even need to depend on one another. We can figure this out. And arrogance eventually gives way to apathy, gives way to atrophy and death. It's probably a little bit of what the church in Sardis had experienced, where they had had a great start. They had had a lot of things that were a part of their body and gathering and witness that was just a great, tremendous beginning. And they probably let confidence give way to arrogance, and arrogance gave way to apathy, and apathy gave way to atrophy, and they thought they were alive. And Jesus says, now you guys are actually the furthest thing from it. And so he tells them, stay close to me. To the church in Philadelphia, this is the second of two churches that are not given any correction, but rather given just commendation. And the church in Philadelphia is given that as well, like the church in Smyrna. And there we see what it looks like to live with an eternal focus. Perhaps the question then is just as simple as that. Do we live with an eternal focus like Jesus? The church in Philadelphia was not fearing of their lives physically, but had been pushed out and marginalized. They had lost influence. They weren't the people that the city officials went and looked for counsel from. The ideas that faith in God or a relationship with Jesus or the Bible would have anything to do with modern society would not have been on the radar of the officials of the town of Philadelphia. And the church gets pushed to the margins because of it. But we see that they are commended for living with an eternal focus. Jesus lived with an eternal focus, and we're told that as the days drew near for him to be taken up, that he set his face to Jerusalem. The Gospels record for us three different moments before Jesus rides in to Jerusalem on the colt or the foal of a donkey. That he tells his disciples, I'm going to go, I'm going to die, and then I'm going to rise again. And they didn't get it. They didn't understand it. It's like the dots didn't connect for them, in part because they were not filled with the Holy Spirit at that point in the way that would come later on. And John tells us as much in chapter 20 of his gospel account. When they get to the empty tomb, he reflects back and goes, yeah, we didn't really understand what was to go on here. And it surprised us. And then the dots begin to connect. But we see that Jesus knew exactly what was going on. Jesus knew exactly what was awaiting for him. He knew exactly what was coming. And there was an eternal focus in part to his actions and his purpose. And the church in Philadelphia models that. And Jesus does not confront them, but rather comforts them, commends them, and again, commands them to hold fast. Church, stay close to me. Well, the last of the seven letters is to the church in Laodicea, and it is this church that there is nothing good said about. It is this church that has perhaps been diluted, self-deceived, into thinking that they're doing exactly what they're to be doing. And Jesus says, you repulse me. And it's in that church we get a glimpse of what it looks like to live with passion for Jesus. Are you going to be cold and refreshing? Are you going to be hot and soothing? Or are you going to be kind of this bland in the middle, Jesus says to them. And confronting them, he goes, look, you're not cold or refreshing. You're not hot and soothing. You're lukewarm, and it leads me to spit you out of my mouth. And he tells them, be zealous. Repent. That word zealous is the idea of passion. Be passionate. Stand for something. Live with something, be willing to sacrifice with something or for something, be cold and refreshing, be hot or soothing, but don't just find a way to kind of not make a wave. Be passionate, be known for something. And we see that focus in that passion, if you will, show up in the life and ministry of Jesus. Perhaps most simply summarized, Jesus came to seek and save the lost. It's why he set his face to Jerusalem. It's why he spent his life in his ministry, years of his life, showing and demonstrating with signs and wonders and miracles that he was God and was the Messiah and had the authority as God and the purity to die as the perfect Lamb of God, to take away these sins, to seek and save the lost. To the Laodiceans, Jesus is asking them to be passionate. Stay close to me. And in the book of Hebrews, chapter 1 and 2, that author tells us that it was for joy that Jesus went to the cross. We call his actions on the cross the passion. And we see in Jesus another example to follow. And we see in what he writes to the church in Laodicea what he would call us to. But once again, church, these are not just things that we need to somehow write down on two different columns to find ourselves working through as a checklist day in and day out. These are the very things that are Jesus' best for us. But we pursue these things by staying close to him, by walking with the Spirit, that we may not gratify the desires of the flesh, that we would do what it was that Jesus wanted us to do and not do what it is that he tells us not to do, that we would love well and stand for truth well and have passion well and count the cost well, and all of these things that he outlines and identifies throughout all of these seven letters across these two chapters. He doesn't intend for you and I to find strength in ourselves to go and complete these tasks. He rather empowers us to do what he calls us to do, and does so by his Spirit. And to walk with the Spirit, it's not this tremendously secretive formula. It's to spend time with him in prayer, in his word, and with his people, that we may know what it is that he has said, we may find life in what it is that he has said, that we may hear what the Spirit has said to these churches, to our church. And because the Spirit empowers us for obedience, there's not a single thing that Jesus commends that we are incapable of doing. There's not a single thing that Jesus condemns that we will not ever find power or mastery over. But it's not found in our own strength. It's found in his. And he gives it to us. And it is he alone who is worthy. And it is he alone who has given us his helper, his Spirit, that we might follow him well. As the band comes to close, would you pray with me? Well, Jesus, we pray that you would help us to stay close to you. That you alone are worthy of all blessing and honor and glory. And so, Jesus, we ask that you would help us to not try and find this afternoon or tomorrow morning strength in ourselves to follow what it is that you have said, but strengthen you, and that we would draw near. God, we admit that there's a brokenness in our world that we feel, and an angst that we have grief over. But there are tremendous promises that you have made, that you love us. So help us to stay close to you, Jesus. We pray this in your good name. Amen. Would you stand as they close us?
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
shadows deepen.
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made? All creation groaning.
It
is a new creation coming.
It is.
And is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? Worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and a lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Blessing and honor and glory. Is he worthy of this?
He is.
Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He died.
And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those he loves?
He died.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He died.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom of priests to God, to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is, he is, he is, he is, he is worthy. He is worthy of a blessing and honor and glory. He is worthy of this. He is, he is, he is, he is, he is worthy. He is worthy of a blessing and honor and glory. He is worthy.
Amen. We're going to need to transition to the business meeting, and so it's always abrupt and a little awkward, but we'll get that going here in about 7 minutes or so. So if you need to hit that restroom, you want to grab another bottle of water, please feel free to do that and then make your way back into here. That would be great.
Thanks again for joining us, and be sure to